Harry, you want to go take a walk? Right?
Derek, good morning. How are you?
Good. How are you? Nice to finally meet you. Nice to finally meet you.
Yes.
So thank you for this, first off. And hopefully you like what I have prepared. And I really appreciate you coming on today.
Oh, thank you very much. It's a pleasure.
I have to say, very honestly, so I've had almost 400 guests, some really wonderful people. With your filmography, I almost feel overwhelmed. I mean, short of keeping you on here for 8 hours and going through everything individually, I had to really cut it down. And, you know, a lot of your work, I feel like for me, is a path through history, a path through my life, a path through movies that really affected me and blew me away. So first, I thank you for that. And second of all, it's a really testament to what kind of talent you really are.
Oh, thank you.
Let me ask you, first of all, how are you? Because I know you were a bit of an accident and I'm glad you're okay. Is everything okay on your end?
I did. A lot of people might say it's old age caused it, but it wasn't. It was a little accident, and I had 10 staples in my head and 8 stitches in my foot, so it sort of slowed me down physically and mentally there for a little while. Not long, I might add.
Yes. You're back up and at it, and that's a good thing. And I know that, John, is it a fair statement to say that you travel a lot?
Derek, I used to during work-wise because my preference was to live here in Australia and go to work anywhere in the world that was demanded. By doing that, it meant that, yes, I put in a lot of time crossing the Pacific to the Americas, a lot of time going to Europe the other way. So I did an awful lot of traveling to get to and from certain job aspects, which I didn't mind because, you know, we are Australian. We love Australia. The kids were coming up in their schools, and I didn't want to drag them around the world on and off different countries. I mean, we did enough of that as it was without taking them out of school permanently. So I preferred to live here and put up with the travel.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because podcasting, I meet people that travel and whatnot. It works out so funny sometimes because I'm speaking with you today. Tomorrow, I have an actor from New Zealand. What are the chances that back-to-back interviews would be from the other part of the world? I mean, you never, it's just funny how life works, John, I guess.
It is.
Yeah. You know, first of all, I have to do say that all great people are born in October. I have to tell you that. that is a fact. So, you know, there's a ton, I have no idea where to start. I have to say, I picture your early life very much. So I was watching The Fablemans, right? And I've always pictured, and I've heard stories of Spielberg with the camera early on. You know, as a kid, you could never get the camera away from him. Are there shades of that in your life, John, growing up, where you cannot get away from the camera? The camera's kind of yours. And did the bug bite you early on?
Look, Derek, it did a little bit. A couple of mates and I used to, in those very early days when they finally brought out small 8mm cameras, I did buy one and we would make little movies. We'd put makeup on and, you know, we'd burn corks and put it on as a, you know, the baddies always had a bit of a beard going. And we made funny little movies in our home area. But then later, as I got older and more into the later teens, left school, I took off into the outback. And luckily, I took this little 8mm camera with me, and for no other reason than to simply record the life that I was living out on a quite a large sheep station in central Queensland, simply to record the life and send it back to my parents and say, this is what I'm doing, this is what I have to do, weekly, daily, whatever. But in the end, I was there for 2 years and absolutely loved it. I got thrown off horses. You know, we had a big prop. It was a big property by a lot of standards. It was 32,000 acres. So our horse paddock was 4,000 acres. So finding the horses at 3 o'clock in the morning was quite an exercise, but I loved all that. And I filmed it. And as I said, there was no intent that the film was anything other than a memory, visual memory of what I was doing. But at the end of 2 years, when the drought broke, because I didn't see rain for 2 years, we lost so many head of sheep. And I decided that life out there was pretty tough. And I'd been looking at this little camera for a year and thinking, gee, I wonder if I could go back to Sydney, find a job as a photojournalist, movie journalist, travel the world and go to places that people weren't game to go to or couldn't afford to go to, whatever. And I would go and film them. And I thought, that's what I'm going to do. So when the drought broke, and it was just devastation, it really was. And I felt so much for the people. I thought maybe in the future I could do documentaries about that, which I ended up doing actually, with the ABC in Australia. So that's how it all evolved. And I came back to Sydney and I joined the Australian government TV station. Best apprenticeship I could have ever done. 7 years there with some of the most garrulous old ex-World War II and Korean War cameramen, combat cameramen. Always celebrated that they were alive every day. So I learned it hard and fast. And but the 7 years was so good because I did span all aspects of cinematography, from documentaries of orchestras to back out into the outback to do documentaries on animal husbandry. I did hard news, periodic news, documentaries, and then finally the ABC slowly moved into drama, what they call drama. And I moved into that, and boy, was I excited then to go to the outback, which I loved. But I've got actors in front of the camera. That was just crazy. I just fell in love with that from day one, and here I am.
John, what do you consider, and I've heard you kind of say this answer in other interviews, what do you consider your break, your first big break in the sense that you came to the States to start movie making? What's your big break when it comes to the States, do you think, that you would say, this is the movie that really transitioned me from coming to Australia to now I'm in the States and a movie maker? What would you say to that, John?
I've got to admit, I think that it was the first film that I came to America to help make, and that was Peter Weir's Witness.
Yes, great movie.
I was terrified. One, because I was going to America, which was the home of movie making as far as the modern world was concerned. Peter Weir, I was very familiar with. I had been able to help on six of his movies, sorry, three of his movies at that stage in Australia, and terrified that it was Harrison Ford because he was Mr. Indiana Jones, and I never worked with anybody of that caliber in the film industry. And I must say, he quickly allayed any fears. I must say, he's a lovely, lovely man. And he is a normal human being who happens to be an actor. So that fell away pretty quickly. But I think then Peter's fantastic and amazing directorial abilities made a very, very interesting cop movie. And that, I think, as an interesting movie, then of course segued into Academy nominations for quite a number of us. And as I found out in America, the adage, you know, once you're nominated, you never have to worry about work again, kind of came true. Absolutely yeah. came true. So I've got to say that first film was the turning point. After that, I was approached a lot to work in America.
Yeah, and you work with Harrison Ford twice. You mentioned The Witness, but also Mosquito Coast. Do you find, and you mentioned what a very affable and kind man he was. Do you find that when the second movie rolls around, he's just very used to your style? He's very used to what he's going to, you know, your rapport is a good rapport. Do you feel like at that point, by the second movie, you guys are fine as far as, you know, being comfortable with each other?
I think so, and I hope so. I think it did happen that way because there was no question. Very often, very big box office actors will demand to know who the cameraman is. And I do believe that there's been changes in the cameraman because of that. But with Harrison, no. The second film, it was like, hail, hearty, well met, here we go again. Mm. And it was with the great Peter Weir. So I think we're all very, very comfortable going into a very complex film too, Mosquito Coast.
For sure.
Beautifully written by Paul Theroux and a very interesting subject matter. But maybe it was one that was a little complex for a lot of people, but I think we all found it complex to make. But luckily, because of that camaraderie, I think the problems were smoothed out very quickly and easily.
Yeah, and for those listening or watching, you mentioned nominations. You've been nominated 5 times. Mad Max, Fury Road, Cold Mountain, Rain Man, Witness. You won for The English Patient. You know, and just going over some other things. I mean, I talked about being overwhelmed. You know, Harry Potter, Dreamcatcher, The Perfect Storm, City of Angels, you know, The Firm. A lot of these talented Mr. Ripley, they, you know, Gorillas in the Mist is a beautiful, like, there's so much, like, I could go on, and I know you've had this list regurgitated to you many times, but for those listening, you're like, oh my god, yes, oh yes, like, it's, and that's why when I was putting this together, I'm like, my goodness gracious, it's almost overwhelming to go over your career, because there's so, these movies are so beautiful, John, and they hold up so well.
Oh, that's lovely, thank you so much, Derek, for that. Gosh, it's very interesting being a cinematographer because we're all different, and yet we make the same film, types of films, but we're all different the way we approach that that subject of cinematography. I feel that in the early days, I felt that I wanted to always portray the cinematography to suit the script, the era, and the geography, and so that the audience would always believe that that was the real case, that,
yeah,
you know, Harrison Ford in Mosquito Coast was in the Belizean jungle. And it's not a pretty jungle. And Peter Weir said, I don't want a pretty jungle. I want an ugly jungle that only Ali Fox would love, the character. Mm. And mm. everybody else would look at it and go, who the heck would go there? So by honouring that, we decided on a film negative that really didn't like green, and the whole forest was green.
Yeah.
So it gave it a grubby look that I think Peter was happy with. And I think then that was the honesty of the story, in a way, that really only the character of Ali Fox could see the beauty in that jungle, mm. and the rest of the audience couldn't. And that made the film very much part of its complexity as a film, as a man who wants to leave the virtues of America and go live in the deep, dark, you know, insect-ridden jungles of Belize. And I think by honouring that as a cinematographer, I think was the honesty of the eventual film.
Yeah, that's well said. Before I move on from that, you know, when you did win the Academy Award, one of the people you were up against was the icon Roger Deakins for Fargo, which is a gorgeous movie. Is there any, I don't want to say, I don't know how to phrase this. I was struggling with this. So knowing that you were nominated with Roger Deakins and won, does it make the award that much more valuable, I guess, as far as sentimentally valuable because of who you went against to earn it? Is that, I mean, it's a roughly worded question, but I would say beating Roger Deakins or being nominated or regarded in that class is pretty remarkable.
Roger and I get on so well. We kind of liked each other the moment we met, and we had been up against each other on one other occasion, I think, with something, and no, we got on so well, and he was the first one a couple of years ago when I said, I'm going to retire. I'm out of this game. I'm too old. And he said, don't you ever retire. And I love that because much that I had won, sorry, I hate using the word won. I had been awarded Academy Award for a film that he was nominated in as well, had nothing to do with it. Really and truly between us, there's no competition. He's a brilliant cinematographer, and I think by virtue of the brilliance of Anthony Minghella and Michael Ondaatje's brilliant book and the adaptation of that by Anthony, and I think and hope that with my cinematography that was, again, I hope, was loyal to the subject, to the geography, to the era.
Yeah.
To make the audience feel comfortable that was worthy of the award. I really hope that. And I think deep down, I think because of what Roger said a couple of years ago when I was really, and I have done actually, retired, I think that his remark is a very honest remark of somebody who appreciated my work, I hope, and I've appreciated his, and that's all there is to it.
Yeah, and that's why I struggled with the wording, because I didn't want to say one, and I don't want to say, like, you beat, like, it didn't sound right, but, like, the fact that you're in the same company, and you guys, I have no doubt, are friends. I was like, how do I ask him this without making it sound like you're gloating? So, yeah, you answered it perfectly. Yeah. So,
the word win, who wins, the winner is, has always worried me. I've always, and I think the Academy has picked up on that they want to now say, and the award goes to, because if you get nominated, you're a winner, hands down. You've been regarded as one of the best five in the world at that moment. Thank God it's only for one moment. Next year there's another 300 cameramen
who can
vie for it, but I think it should always be that the award goes to, so the others don't feel like they're losers.
Yeah,
Nobody wants to be a loser, really.
Speaking of Academy Award, is that it over your left shoulder behind you?
It's there somewhere, I think.
Yeah, yes, it's right. I think it's right in the middle. Yep. Wow.
Yep.
Very nice.
I'm not allowed to show it.
Really? I didn't know that.
They're very strict. They don't like you photographing it and using it for any kind of purpose. If it happens to be on a shelf in the background,
oops, there we what go. Are you gonna, yeah. Do you feel like there's a difference in movie making, John? I mean, not 100%, but like just generally, because there's times where, listen, Netflix has some wonderful shows, Hulu, all these networks have some wonderful shows. But there's times I feel like it's almost like a cookie cutter. Like, let's get this out. When I hear stories about or read about your life in the movie making in the 80s, the 70s, the 90s, you know, early 2000s, I feel like there's a lot that goes in it. I feel like there's, I don't want to say movies, like, I don't want to sound like the person that says, well, in my day, the music was better. But, like, I feel like movie making was much more thought out. It was much more, they weren't trying to pump it out just to get it out. Does that make sense, John?
It does, Derek, because, you know, up until the digital revolution, a cinematographer was a photographer and had to expose the negative of a film that would be then traveled on through the process of a positive and then a release prints. And you handled all of that. And the photography side of cinematography became really, in a way, I felt what the award was given for.
Right.
Now the digital revolution has made life so much easier, maybe, because the photography seems to have gone. The actual process of photography has gone, and it's now a recording of digital image that is, you light it now off a monitor. And having done Fury Road and 3,000 Years of Longing for George Miller with on the digital cameras for the first time, they're fascinating little things, and they're amazing in low light areas. Where we used to battle in the early days with slow rating film negatives, and we'd have to really light everything and try to make it look as real to that era, geography, whatever, as possible, was really, I think, the art of the photography within cinematography. In a way, that has been diminished by these unbelievable cameras that can shoot in the dark, basically, and still look reasonably good. I do feel they look better on a small monitor than a big screen. And I think sometimes people are being trapped a little bit, maybe, in being asked to keep shooting in a situation where the image on that little monitor looks good. But when you blow it up on a big screen, it can sometimes fall apart a bit. But anyway, that's an apprenticeship that they'll all go through, I think. Realizing that maybe a little bit of photography within the digital cinematography has to be mixed in, blended in as well. But it's a brilliant system. I mean, what it's done. But there are a lot more people involved in your image making. Your visual effects man and your colorist, and your DIT man, your DIT man on the set who's controlling your image with these little buttons. You can actually grade it right there as you shoot it. Whereas in the older photography days, you sat alone with a colorist in a little dark room for 3 weeks, grading your picture to what you felt the director, the script, the geography, the era all needed. In a package, and you did it all by yourself with that colorist. And nowadays is quite a lot more complex, a lot more people involved in that image. So it's a whole new era, really.
Well, speaking of the previous era, you should have been nominated for Dead Poets Society. I just want to add that. I mean, talk about a movie that changed my life, and we're going to hop to that in a moment. One of the quotes that I heard you say, I almost fell in love with it. And I hope you said it, otherwise I'm going to be really embarrassed. Was you were talking about your granddaughter, and I think she said to you she was watching Dead Poets Society in school, or something along those lines. Your granddaughter was talking about your work, and that melted my heart. Like that was like, oh, like a generation of kids that can appreciate a movie that didn't come out a year ago or yesterday. And oh my God, for kids to be talking about the classic, a classic like that. That made my heart just like, So.
Well, of course, it goes back, Derek, to the brilliance of Peter Weir in creating the emotion of boys in a school and a teacher whose love of the students and life, the word, the poetry is a brilliant piece of filmmaking. I think it's the great one of the. I have to admit that it's the greatest compliment what I've really had to have our granddaughter ring up and say, "Guess what we're watching at school?" And to be told that it was Dead Poets Society was really fantastic. But like you, it just warms your heart completely because it's such a brilliant story about being in a school, being searching of life, you know, search for the honey off the tongue, all of that beautiful, simple philosophies of life put into a film that schools are using to say to children, you know, you'll have your hard times in your life, but always try to keep the honey on the tongue, you know, keep the sweetness of life going. Because those dramas are, you know, possibly going to encircle you. And it's the learning of of wisdom of to me to be asked to do a film of that caliber and magnitude is such an honor. It's such an honor, and it's so wonderful to hear you say this same thing, that the film is such a powerful piece of message making.
Dead Poets is the definition of what a timeless movie is, as is Rain Man, which we're going to get into in a moment, but they are timeless. Do you ever find yourself in movies, we'll just say Dead Poets Society here, getting emotional while you're filming, John?
Oh, very much so. Oh gosh, one of my greatest loves of helping to make films was watching actors through the camera, through the lens, strutting their stuff. And that's one of the things that kept driving me. I was offered a lot of big action movies, and I passed on quite a lot of them. A couple I did, which I shouldn't have done, but we won't talk about that. Most of them, I wanted to work with the actors. I just felt that what they do in front of a camera or in front of an audience is just amazing. And I tried through my life to professionally make their comfort zone in front of that camera as comfortable as possible. Give them all the room that they needed. Give them all the freedom they needed to play their character, because they're crazy people, you know. They they're one person, and they have to hit the set running as another person with a different character, with different lifestyle, words and things that they had to learn. And I found that that was one of the most exciting parts of all of the filmmaking. And to be privileged to work with Dustin Hoffman and Harrison Ford, and oh my God, and Tom Cruise. I mean, all, and look, Robin Williams, what a lovely, lovely man he was. And to work with him, all of them, it was just extraordinary. It just powered me on all the time to keep selecting movies that I felt had that built into them, that lovely characters that these actors would have to strive to find and work hard to make it real. And I loved that. And as I said, tried to make their life as comfortable as possible. It's very exciting thing to do. And you get paid, for God's sake. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah, my next question was going to be about Robin Williams. Your thoughts on him shooting that movie and his talent, what he brought, your experience with him, whatever you want to add to that.
Robin, he was so lovely. He was Peter Weir, always had a most amazing casting choices. And when I heard that Robin Williams was playing the teacher, I said, hold up, you know, he's an amazing stand-up comedian. But as the school teacher, and he just proved otherwise. He just set himself into that task, and that's where I felt that he needed a lot of help, as much as we could give to him on the set. And he has to make people laugh. And every now and again, he'd suddenly stop and he would roll into some amazingly funny dialogue. And Peter would let him go. And Peter would let him go for maybe 8 minutes or something like that. And then he'd say, righto, Robin, we've got to get back to work. Oh, yes, boss. Yes, back to work. And off we'd go. And he'd slink into a corner and quietly work himself back into the teacher that he was playing. And I just found that absolute, I know, the saddest moment of my life was reading that he'd passed away by his own hand. I was so sad for that.
Heart-wrenching, you know, and it's funny, John, because his best movies are the ones that were serious. Good Will Hunting, Dead Poets Society. Mrs. Doubtfire is a comedy, but it's very serious too. It's about, you know, living with divorce. So it's funny how comedy has that side. And yeah, I can't imagine what it must have been like for you being on the other side of that camera, just watching this amazing man. I mean, nominated for an Academy Award. I mean, he was in a tough category that year, but like, my God, I mean, just watching that man. But like, you talk, and I get that you're very grateful and you are certainly appreciative of your life. But John, you've earned your way here. It's not like you won this lottery where you're behind the camera. Like, you worked really hard to get where you are today, and the filmography that you have. That's all a byproduct of your hard work.
Well, it all started too in the early days of a ladder you had to climb. And, you know, I was a clapper loader, and then I was a focus puller, and all those steps are your learning apprenticeship to becoming a cinematographer. And out of it, if you listen and watch while you're filming in the other jobs, you're learning as well about the relationship of an actor to a camera, to other actors, to the director, to the editor. You know, all of those the actor needs to relate to. And a lot of, I hope, and well, a lot of my philosophies that I kept through the years, it came out even long before I got behind a camera, because I saw cameramen arguing with a director about the best angle. Well, this will be prettier.
Yeah.
And the director saying, but I want the drama of this angle, which hasn't got the prettiness. And the argument would go on and on. And I used to think, if ever I get there and become a cameraman, I'm going to shoot what he wants, because what he's saying is that's his film.
Yeah, yeah.
The director's film. And he wants the drama of the cinematography to match the script and the direction and the actors' performances in that era. And we should, that's what we're there for in my mind. So a lot of the philosophies I felt, you know, tried to work towards that end. I must say I'm pretty amazed that by working those philosophies into the cinematography, to me, it was amazing to get nominated so many times, because I never thought that the photography I was doing was pretty enough. I hate using the word pretty, but pretty enough, because a lot of cameramen do shoot for the prettiness. I learned that in my early days, and they argue for it, and I didn't want to do that. So I'm pretty amazed and privileged, I must say, and humbled by the fact that 5 nominations for films that I was hoping would just be simply the cinematography that suited everything that the director and the script wanted.
Yeah, and I have to say, you know, you mentioned your shots and your lensing. I'm going to tell you, I probably see 90% of the movies in a given year, and I have for a long time. But two of the shots that have stuck with me that I'll never shake. One, they both come from Rain Man. One of which is when Tom Cruise is making a call with Dustin Hoffman. They're in a phone booth. They get out. They go in the car, and then we kind of move to a cloudy field, and the sun is coming breaking through the clouds. I don't know if you know the scene I'm talking about. It's one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. Do you know what scene I'm talking about?
Yes, yes.
It is stunning.
I loved working on Rain Man. Rain Man was such a fantastic ensemble film in a way, because Dustin and Tom were bouncing off each other, finding those two characters that would end up brothers and loving each other is such a heavy emotional demand, and working through pre-production, Dustin was so amazing. He would be wandering around the production office, and he's not needed. He's not doing anything, you know, on film in testing or whatever. He's just wandering around. And I said to him about a week out, I said, Dustin, you don't need to be here. You know, we're here. We're doing all our pre-production. You could go home and play tennis and have a beer or something.
Yeah.
And he said, no. He said, I love walking around the office listening to all the crap you guys talk about, you know. And I love that, because there was this amazing actor who wanted to be part of the process of the making of the film as well. So later there was a funny moment that I felt weird about, but I did it, was that 3 days in, we were shooting a little scene where Dustin and Tom are sitting on a bench looking at some ducks in a pond. And then Tom says, come on, we've got to go. We're leaving. Let's get out of here. And they stood up off the bench and Tom walked across the grass straight to the corner of the building. And Dustin followed. And I stood there looking, you know, I had this lovely camera operator and Todd Henry, who was such a lovely man. Anyway, I said to Todd, his character wouldn't walk to the corner. Wouldn't he walk straight to the path, then walk down the path to the corner? Isn't that his mind? And Dustin said, well, tell Dustin. I said, and at that stage, I didn't feel I could do it. And so he said, I'll do it. So he went over to Dustin and he said, Dustin, would Raymond go straight to the corner and just follow, or would he go to the path, then down? And Dustin said, my God, who thought of that? And he said, John did. He said, oh, my God, I got a cameraman who can think for my character. And I was his best mate after that. I was his best friend.
Yeah.
But I use it. I'm hoping I'm not just building myself up.
No, not at all.
I'm using it to sort of say that when you sort of watch Dustin wandering around the production office, getting into the groove with us, that we should be doing the same thing, getting the groove with the actors. And I must confess that wasn't very subtle. We didn't go through Barry Levinson. We should have, but it happened that way and it worked out well. And after that, Dustin rang me after the movie was over and done and he'd got an Academy. He used to ring occasionally and just have a chat about life and say, I'm doing a movie, I want you to shoot it, I'm going to direct it. And I'd say, send a script, Dustin, but a script never arrived, sadly, for years, and it never did. So he obviously didn't get to do it, but maybe. But we kind of bonded on that, and I loved that as an epitome of what I was, I hope, striving to do for film.
Yeah, and it's amazing because I've always heard you you're always in total support of the actors, and to hear that kind of justifies that and makes that certainly concrete. Is it weird to see Dustin Hoffman go from before you're shooting, kind of just, you know, a guy that's talking to you about whatever, and then back at the character? Is that a strange transformation that you see unfold?
It's funny again, because in that pre-production, he said to me, he said, you know, and we're only 5 days out, 5 working days out from starting to shoot. And he said in the office there, he said, you know, I haven't found Raymond. And I said, you better hurry up. We've got 5 days. We roll cameras next Monday.
Yeah.
I said, you better hurry up and find him. And he said, yeah, I don't. So, and again, that's what I find so wonderful about actors, is that they have to find it and become confident in this weird character they have to play, or nasty character, or bad character, or good character, whatever type of character. And Dustin was struggling to find that. He obviously found it, and I think, you know, he found more and more of it as the film went on, subtly found more and more, which was lovely. And it was just, and he was so lovely, because when he was nominated, he always said Tom should have got nominated, because Tom had to change character. He said, I didn't. I just had to stay Rain Man. But Tom's character had to change and go from this, who the hell is this guy, you know, to like, you're my brother, you know. I love you, you know. And I love Dustin for that. Passing the buck, give him the Academy Award. I didn't have to do much. I loved all that.
Yeah, that's well said. And the other iconic scene that I love, and maybe the most iconic, is the shots of them walking away from Walbrook in that. Oh my God! Like when you think of Rain Man, when I guarantee, John, when everyone thinks of Rain Man, that's the scene they have in their head. Or when they think of a great movie from a different era, that's the scene. These two guys, and there's so many great angles that it comes in at. Oh, that's beautiful. That's beautiful cinematography, John.
It was a film, what I call a what-if film. What if we shoot at this from here? What if we shoot it from there? And they walk across, do that and do that. Let the actors have a go at it. Yep, we like that. Okay, let's shoot it.
Yeah.
And we just ran across America, and that's the way we shot the film. It was my pre-production with Barry is an interesting one being a contemporary film, there was no style to put into the film particularly, except for camera movement style, maybe. And I couldn't, I was doing everything I could to think about how to do it. Barry and I went to lunch and had a look, and he said, look, it's a contemporary film. We're going to drive across America. Let's just go shoot it. And I said, let's just go shoot it. But it was all because I'd already met Dustin and Tom, and Dustin was showing this amazing man who was going to create Raymond. And I thought, this is going to be such an interesting film because we're just going to go out and shoot it. What if? Yeah. Which is amazing. And I love doing that. And Dustin was going to go, I'll find him and we'll have a movie.
And you know something, I rewatched it over the weekend. I rewatched many of the movies over the weekend knowing that we were going to speak. And I have to say, you're right. I mean, well, and Dustin's right too. Cruz, I don't know if it's his job, but during that movie, all he does is set up Dustin Hoffman, like with his performance. It's so selfless. And it's like, I didn't pick up on it when I was younger. I didn't pick up on it. But like I rewatch it again. I'm like, holy cow, Cruz is really setting this up for Hoffman. He's setting it up for the audience. What a selfless actor, John.
Yeah. But the two of them were just incredible. And there is a little note halfway through the film that changed my whole life as a cinematographer, that I started using multiple cameras.
Yes.
And it was the scene in the little restaurant where the toothpicks fall on the floor and the discussion goes on about how many toothpicks. Now, I suddenly realized that the actors in their ad-libbing, we would have to cover Tom. If I remember, it was Tom. We'd have to cover Tom as a separate shot. And it worried me because I thought, that means he's got to go and learn the ad-lib lines between he and Dustin and the girl. And he's got to learn those, and then we've got to set a camera up, and it'll be so boring. And I thought, we should be cross-shooting on this. We should have two cameras on this. And I went to Barry and I said, Barry, they're ad-libbing. We should be cross-shooting. And he went, duh. it was that changeover period of cinematography where you didn't, you know, we were still in the formulaic photography of movies where you did a wide shot, medium shot, close up, and you only used fixed lenses. You didn't use zooms. Well, I've been using zooms all my life. I love them.
Yeah.
And people said, oh, you don't get the quality out of them. And I said, I don't care about the quality. I love the idea that you can creep in on somebody, or you can change the frame size very quickly and not disturb the actor with a 14 and a half minute wait while we change lenses, put the focus on, recalibrate, do all of that rubbish. Zoom stops all that. And so I was using zooms. So I said to Barry, we weren't even carrying two cameras. We carried one main camera and a spare body, which Panavision said, because I was always a Panavision man, who they said, if you use it, we'll charge you for it. If you don't, it's a spare body to get you out of trouble. So I said, quick, get the spare body thing, and it's an emergency. So we set it all up. And from that day on, until the last film I made, I shot multiple cameras. Wow. Anything up to 12 of them on Fury Road, anything up to 6 on Harry Potter, anything up to 4 on any other movie. As you know, I had to do a lot of hard talk to the office to get the crews needed to operate focus pull all these cameras and the equipment. I had to do a lot of hard talking, but the word went round slowly that we could shoot whole scenes in a morning rather than take 2 days to do it.
Right.
You got a better performance and you got better continuity cutting for the editor. Editors loved it.
Yeah.
They said, I can cut for performance, not for continuity.
Yeah.
And I thought, yes, must be making a better movie.
Yeah. So
I went to multiple cameras forever.
Yeah, and that must have been tough at first to try to sell people on that idea, right? Because it was pretty much a single shot, kind of a lot of the movies at the time before you arrived. And then people see your work. I would imagine after a while, people see your work and they're a little more understanding and a little more, okay, John knows what he's talking about. Let's kind of do this, right? You're not, I have to imagine after a certain point, it's not such a hard sell, John, right?
No, it became, as you say, as the movies rolled on and the word of mouth went round that he's going to, they all talk between each other. I don't know. They probably said, you know, what's he like? Is he expensive? Does he use a lot of equipment? Yeah, but it's multiple cameras.
Yeah.
And so you'll get that value back in production time. I hope that's what was said. It also created quite a challenge in lighting because there was a standard accepted in the American system and the world system, to be honest, of quality. And there was a big belief that one camera was the only way to get that quality so that you could put in every little backlight, kickers, you know, things that to make it a commercial. But I'd very early in my life decided I wasn't going to shoot commercials for feature films, that the reality of the commercial lighting wasn't and wouldn't be acceptable in a feature film that's set in a total contemporary reality. So I didn't get worried or phased about the fact that the lighting for multiple cameras, even the six that we constantly used on Harry Potter, became the challenge of being able to light to a degree that, again, I'll have to say the humbleness of being nominated for the likes of half of Rain Man and any other film after that, which I used multiple cameras, to be nominated for that is very humbling because that was the challenge, was to get the quality of multiple camera individual shots up to what might have been and could have been single camera.
Yeah, and John, does your rapport, speaking of Rain Man, does your rapport with Tom Cruise, right? So you shot him in Rain Man and then the wonderful movie Firm. Does he understand? Are you comfortable with each other because you've worked with each other before?
Is that I hope so. A lot of the actors were very comfortable with the multiple cameras because they could flow and they could react between each other and know that they were both being covered and that the editor could cut for performance. And I think that once that sinks in, to me that was part of my big desire to make the set as comfortable a work zone for them as possible. And to do that, the multiple camera, I think, helped. Maybe some actors might have preferred the single camera so their performance could be honed in the close-up. I never did find out from any of the actors whether that was a preference, but it crossed my mind that it might have been. So I tried to sort of, I mean, I remember one actor saying, John, I can't do this. And I didn't hesitate. I said, done, that camera's gone. We'll do that as a separate setup. He said, thanks a lot. I can't do it. And it wasn't anything to do with performance. It was eyeline. And we had to try and cheat his eyeline a little closer to that camera, which was a demand I should never have put on him.
Yeah.
But because we were rushing and we had the cameras there, I tried to do it, knowing that he's a very seasoned actor, that it might not affect him. A younger actor, less experience, might have been thrown a bit, but I think, but he was just very quick and quietly just said, I can't do this. I said, done, camera's gone, out.
Yeah.
And he was much more comfortable. And then we moved the camera across to the other actor and was able to get it in. And that was because I was using multiple cameras. So that was a nice little thing, but it didn't matter. By the end of the movie, he was the one who came up and said, I guess I'll only be able to ever work this way again if you and Wolfgang Peterson do a movie that I happen to be in. And I said, well, I hope not. I hope your next movie is as comfortable if that's what you were. He said, I was.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. And, you know, it's you mentioned the Harry Potter Sorcerer's Stone. It's one of the most important movies in that series because it really connects they turn from kind of kids into young adults. It's kind of the bridge movie. It's a very important movie. And you mentioned multiple camera shots. It's a really, really well shot movie, John. John, I wanted to ask you a few more questions. Thank you for all this time. I appreciate it so much. John, you know what people, I wish people would, because there was a time in the Academy where they wanted to take cinematography and during the Academy Awards and make it off camera, right? They wanted to give the award off camera, not during the show. Same thing with film scores. I got to tell you, and people were in an uproar when they tried. I don't know if you remember, it's like 2019. I'm like, you have to be out of your mind to think that cinematography, to me, when I see a movie, it's all about cinematography and film scores. I am all about it. To make those secondary awards, it kind of made me lose a little respect for the Academy, John. I felt like they're not, like, in that position, they have to know that. Like, if fans were in an uproar, how does the Academy not get in an uproar? I mean, how do they not realize that the importance of what you do, the importance of what, like, a Thomas Newman is doing? That to me is insane, John, to even think that.
Yeah, I have to agree, Derek, I'm afraid, in that I think they were going through a period where they weren't too sure how to present a popular program, and that getting maybe pushing technical awards to another time and just putting them up as clips was the way to go so that they could have other activities in front of the cameras that maybe the public were more interested in. But I do feel that it was not a very wise compromise about the Academy, which is the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Production, that really the editors and the directors and the sound men, and they're all part of creating that film. And I do feel they should be kept to the fore at any big ceremony like that, big award ceremony. I think if they can do it, they should try and keep all of those heads of department up front.
And, yeah.
Because a lot of the public do follow the technical people to a degree, and I think they like to feel that they're being, you know, looked after as an award.
Yeah. John, how essential, so like I'll take Rain Man. We've already talked about how much I love it, the way it's shot. It's one of the most beautifully shot movies. But then you sprinkle in Hans Zimmer's score. It's like, oh my God, like I'm all in. As a cinematographer, how essential is the score to what you're trying to do?
Oh, look, it's amazingly essential. And, you know, your example is perfect. That I loved what Hans Zimmer did with the music on Rain Man. It's so out there and worked so perfectly for the characters and the character development. I've always been so amazed at music men, how they can sit there and watch our images and they rock in during editing time and watch portions of the film being edited. How they ever can hear music to those images just amazes me. And I did say it to one of them one day, I cannot work out and believe how you can hear music to an image. And they said, well, we can't believe the images that you guys put up for us.
That's great.
So there was a lovely camaraderie there between the heads of department, one might say. But my admiration for them is amazing. And Hans Zimmer, of course, just never stops. He goes on and on and on.
Yeah. You know, are there any movies, if you want to name them, that would be great. It's up to you, that you either turned down that or accepted that you regretted? Another, well, I guess we'll go with turned down. Are there any movies over your course of your career where you said, maybe not? And then after the movie came out, it played out, you were like, probably shouldn't have turned that one down. Has it ever happened to you, John?
Oh, there were quite a few on both sides, Derek.
Yeah.
There were some that I would love to have done, and some that I shouldn't have done. But some of the ones that I would love to have done, I lost out. I never, you never know the reason why.
Sure.
You're just told that somebody else is doing the movie. But then you hear years later little excerpts come out about how it didn't work so well. And maybe if I'd gone with that other guy, it might have been a better experience. So
Yeah.
you really don't know. But there were a couple that I really would have loved to have done. I suppose I could mention one was Aviator. I
Yeah.
was learning to fly in LA, and I loved the story of that guy. What's his name?
DiCaprio?
No, the storyline of of the guy.
Oh, Hughes. Hughes. Yeah.
Hughes.
Yeah.
I loved that story as far as aviation was concerned,
Yeah.
and I really wanted. And I did have a. I thought it was a good interview with Martin Scorsese. I really enjoyed it, and it's one of those things where sometimes you do your interview and you walk out and think, God, I've got a good chance on that one. But no, it didn't happen, and I don't know why, but it didn't happen. So I was a bit disappointed with that one. And there are a couple of others, as I said, that I heard about in the grapevine. Maybe should have been the other way, but that doesn't matter. I moved on. I did find that there's awful moments in life of decisions in working on films. A couple of directors I feel were hurt by the fact that I passed on a couple of films, but the reasons were family reasons. My two children went through high school 2 years apart, and it fell on the exact years that a lovely director wanted me to do a movie on each of those years, and I always vowed I'd be there for the kids to see them through the big exam,
Yeah,
help them out. And I had to be there, and I was there. And it's very sad because then you're written off. You're written off forever. It's happened to a couple of lovely people I'd love to have continued working with, but oh well, that's life. And
that is life. And you know, there's times where you look back and it's like, well, you know, what are you going to do? I mean, family's important. Like it's not anyone's fault, but you know, and I'm sure there's reasons for everything, but I don't know. I feel more often than not you've made the right choices. When you did watch Aviator, do you kind of watch it? I think it was Robert Richardson that did it, you know, and how, when you're watching Howard Hughes on, you know, unfold, are there things that you would have done differently? Are there things that you look at and say, he did that really well? It must be fun to contrast how you would have handled it versus what you saw unfold.
I think, as we talked earlier, we're all different in our visual approach to the story. Bob's a very good cameraman, and worked with Martin Scorsese a lot previously. So I
Yeah.
wouldn't mind betting that there was much of that was in the choice. That previous work and thing. It happened before on another film that the actor was going to direct his first film, and he had worked with another cameraman a lot. And but I thought a great interview with him. And but when this cameraman walked in that he'd worked with previously. I was told it was like a pair of old slippers came in and the actor put them on and he felt comfortable. So I lost that one, but I'm sure I would have shot Aviator slightly differently because I'm a different person and I do have a different approach, and it would have been up to, I think, if I'd gone onto it in pre-production to have sort of worked out with Marty Scorsese how he wanted the film to look. But I'm sure it would have been a little different, to say the least, because we are different people. Yeah.
You know, and speaking of what ifs, I always wonder, because I was rewatching The Mosquito Coast, what River Phoenix's life would have been like had he not passed away. River Phoenix is just so good. You know, it's, you talk, and I know if he had not passed, he would have been just as good as his brother, and we would be seeing him in movie after movie. But how good and lucky that you were able to capture him on film, which is wonderful.
Oh, privilege. Absolute privilege. And he was so delightful to work with, really. He put an awful lot into his character, even to the point where I remember at one stage Peter asked him to cool. He was off camera giving Harrison lines, and he was really pouring it out. And if I remember, Peter said, please, you know, just pull back a little bit, keep it, hold it. We want your close-up, because I wasn't in doing multiple cameras then. And so we were going to do his reverse as a single camera, and Peter had to say, pull back on the over shoulders, because save it for your close-up. He just poured it in. He was such a delight, such a delight.
Yeah. You know, I heard you say in Spanglish, James Brooks would shoot 30 to 50 takes. As a cinematographer, can that be infuriating?
I'm sorry, Derek, what was that?
So in Spanglish, James Brooks, he would do, I think he would do like 30 to 50 takes in some scenes.
Oh, that yes.
Yeah. So as a cinematographer, right, does that ever get infuriating or frustrating? Because it's like, well, what is he looking for? And I'm not asking you to badmouth James Brooks, because I know you have a great rapport. But
No.
Is there ever a time where it's like, okay, what are you looking? Like, from your end, can frustration seep its way into that picture?
Oh, there is a little bit. There is a little bit. I mean, it happens on other films as well. Jim did do an awful lot of takes every time. It was amazing.
Yeah.
And it took us a long time to convince him and show him that we actually had multiple cameras on, and we'd already done the reverse. he couldn't believe it. He said, no, we haven't shot that. I said, yeah, that camera over there got. So he'd watch it and he'd say, no, but we're going to do it again. So we'd do 30 takes on that as well. But it took him the whole film. And in the end, he'd say, if we only had two cameras up, he'd say, well, where are the others?
Yeah.
So we trained him into it. But it can be frustrating in that the light will change.
Sure.
Especially, And your continuity shot to pieces, and maybe the continuity is good in the first 10, and then the cloud came in or something, and you had to shoot in cloud, and it won't match the reverses. You know, all of that's a bit of a frustration, but I still feel that overall the shooting of the multiple cameras helped solve a lot of that. But I also deep down had to question, because of working with actors for so many years over so many millions of feet of film running through a camera, that I felt sometimes the best performances are in the first 5 takes, because after that the actor has used up maybe a lot of what he felt that particular moment required.
I would say it's very exhausting for a lot of people. I've heard you say The Perfect Storm was the most difficult movie you've shot. What would be a close second, John, in your filmography? What film, as far as shooting the film, was most difficult for you? I mean, I had some guesses today in my head just looking at your filmography, but if you had to put like 2 and 3, what would you say were the toughest behind The Perfect Storm?
Gosh, you know, Derek, I've almost got to say Poseidon, which was a good movie.
Yeah.
But the difficulty that we're talking about, I feel, is the mechanical difficulties of working on upside down sets or on a trawler, fishing trawler in the middle of the ocean on a soundstage, and trying to get the reality built into that. And it did seem to work, but I had a fantastic crew on both films. They were the same camera crew and grip crews, electrics crews came through as well. So that softened the second one. The first one, they just grabbed hold of all the technical problems that we would have and helped solve them, and
Yeah.
solved them brilliantly. So with that in mind, it became a routine on the set. Oh, okay, we'll do this, we'll do that. We've got that covered. We'll put that in. But and it all happened. It all fell into place. It was brilliant. It was brilliant. But mechanically, what the 3 months I had of pre-production was one of the longest I've ever had. And I have to say, I used every single second of it every day trying to work out how the cameras would get the storyboard. Because
Yeah.
sometimes it's really easy to draw a storyboard picture, and then you think, how am I going to put that on film?
Yeah,
Became the challenge, but again, just a challenge, that's all.
and you've got some wonderful projects. My last question to you is, we talked about your wonderful rapport with Peter Weir, George Miller. I have to think you guys have a wonderful rapport as well. What is it about George that you two are? I mean, you guys, I want to say you came up together or close together, or is that somewhat accurate, John?
We did cross paths in the
Yeah.
early days. Both of those directors I worked with or crossed paths with in the early Australian filmmaking days, back in the 70s into the 80s and 90s, where they blossomed into international directors, and a lot of the Australian people started moving overseas. But I worked more with Peter Weir as a camera operator, with the great Russell Boyd, cinematographer. Russell asked me to do Peter's pictures, and I had worked with Peter on a TV series, an English TV series in Australia. So we knew each other quite well there. And he did ask Russell, could he use me as camera operator on his first film in Australia, second film, sorry, in Australia. And Russell kindly said yes, and that worked out very well, and we rolled on from there. With George, we knew each other socially in the industry. I was interviewed to do the first Mad Max that he was doing in Sydney. Not sorry, the second Mad Max in Sydney. But I wasn't ready, and I knew it. I wasn't ready for that bigger film. And I think I showed it, and George is a very, very astute man. Both of them are, of course. And I think George realized that I was reticent and hesitant to jump into such a big film with so much hanging on it at that stage of my career. And he went for the great Dean Semler, and perfect. Perfect. Couldn't have been a better combination. So I then went on and did more of the lower budget Australian films, and got myself together and my reputation, I think, because I started winning some awards in Australia. I'm sorry, I started being given some awards in Australia, and I think then it blossomed into the ability of Peter to ask me to go overseas to do Witness as a first film. And then with George, I did Lorenzo's Oil a long
Yeah.
time ago with George. I loved George's approach to filmmaking. It's a little bit out there, and I love that on a subject, a medical subject matter that was so intensely emotional. And working with Susan Sarandon and Nick Nolte. Susan Sarandon is just a wonderful person, and working with her was a highlight of my life, actually, on a subject matter like that. So that was good. And then later, when he's looking for somebody for Fury Road, then George picked me up on that. And I was bordering on retirement back then, but I was going to work with George again, and it didn't take much to convince me to go to Africa and get dirty.
Good on you to, I mean, not many people would have turned down the second Mad Max. Not many people would have turned that down. They would have taken it, even though knowing that you that was too big for you and turning it down says a lot. Like, not many people would have done that. People would have said, yeah, I'll do it, no problem. And then find out too late that, oh my God, this is way too much for me. So not many people would have done that.
George would be fairly demanding with what he would like to show on the screen. And I really didn't feel I was quite there. It took, I remember, another two low budget films to shoot for me to get that confidence. And in fact, when I did light my first film, I got such a shock, I went back to operating. And a lot of lovely people in Australia said, don't do it. Don't go back to operating, because they won't believe you'll ever be a cinematographer. A director of photography.
Yeah.
And I said, no, life's too long and too short to worry about that sort of thing. So I went back to my love, and part of it was operating for Peter on the film Gallipoli.
Yeah.
We talked about it. I started lighting, and then 3 or 4 years later, Peter got Gallipoli together, and he and Russell asked me to operate on it, and I was going to operate on it. That's all there was to it. So I rebuffed these other people and said, no, I'm operating, and I'm so glad I did. It's such a lovely, powerful film, very simply put together, and it's the beauty of Peter Weir's thinking as a film director, the simplicity of life but smothered in the complexities of life, and it all comes out. It's so lovely. So I'm so glad I did that, and then I went and started lighting, and then, well, just kept going after that. I felt that my confidence in lighting had returned, and away I went.
Yeah. How beautifully insane is it in Fury Road when they're the guitarist with the flames? Like, I mean, come on. I could rewatch that time and time again. John, is there anything that somebody could say to you to get you out of retirement?
I'm sorry, that...
Is there anything that somebody could say to you to get you out of retirement? Is there any project you would come out of retirement for?
No, Derek.
See, no, John, you hesitated. You know it. See, we need good cinematographers out. And like, I'm happy that you're retired, but I'm selfishly missing the fact that you're not continuing making movies.
I have it honestly in the answer that I'll give, that when we talked about the photography of cinematography, is what I loved. I loved that challenge of photographing a film. In those days, we'd walk out of a film and see a stunt and go, oh my God, how did they do that stunt? You walk out of a film now and you don't care, because you know that the flames were probably put in post. The car rolling over behind him is in post. He's on a green screen. You know, the talent of the cameraman to light the foreground of the green screen to match the background, that's all part of the industry now. But when we were doing those films of Rain Man and that era, that whole 70s, 80s, 90s, it was genuine stuff. It was going onto the negative of the camera. And that challenge, I've talked to other lovely cameramen and said, what, do you miss it? And they go, oh, God, yeah. I said, yeah, we agreed that waking up at 3 a.m. thinking, what was I thinking? Oh, I should open up another half stop on that wide shot. I'm ringing the lab at 4 a.m. saying, can you print that up? Have a look at it, see what you think. And panic, and you never got a good night's sleep. And we all loved it. We all loved it. Now you sleep like a log because you watch your dailies going home in the bus on a little monitor up hooked onto the sun visor of the bus while you drive an hour back to your little hotel. And that's, you've seen dailies because you know that the visual effects boys will grab hold of it, the colorist will grab hold of it, and they'll do what they want to do with it. And there's so many people involved in the final result now that it's sort of like everybody's result in a way. And I miss, like other friends of mine in the industry, as I said, we miss the drama of the photography completely. Because when it worked, you just felt so excited when something came together and worked, or when you tried to think of how can I match all of this to match, and the sun's going to go in and out, it'll go behind a building and the thing will be shadowed, I've got to match that. It was like shooting Telling Mr. Ripley in Italy in the little narrow roadways, and the light was changing. When you'd arrive, it'd be beautiful at 9 o'clock in the morning. It'd be bouncing off a salmon-coloured bill. Beautiful. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, black as pitch.
Wow.
I'd have to keep shooting it, as photography on a negative. And those were the wonderful challenges, plus working with the actors, the director. You had this whole challenge of matching everything to make it work. And really, it's so much easier now. So
yeah.
Much easier.
If you do decide to come back, I'll be the first one in line buying a ticket. I'm a huge fan, John. Your work has sincerely changed my life. It's been a big influence. And thank you so much, John, for this time and for all the work you've done over the course of your life.
Derek, thank you very much. You've humbled me yet again.